for joining us. Screen, oh, on this one. Sorry. Right, I'll start off with an introduction. So I'm Ben Edwards, I'm the Group Head of Cost, Commercial and Procurement at Red Sea Global. Who are Red Sea Global? Red Sea Global is one of the world's most visionary developers, the force behind the ambitious Red Sea destinations of the Red Sea and Amala. We put people and planet first in everything that we do, leveraging innovative concepts, both in the, you know, the technology, the design of the resorts that we are creating, to actively enhance the well-being of the guests, the communities, and the environments within which we are working. Tourism, as you know, is a cornerstone of Vision 2030, and we're very, very proud to be spearheading that at Red Sea Global. And you know, we've opened our first resorts, as I'm going to talk you through this afternoon. And you know, in doing so, we're determined to move the dial in terms of the, you know, the construction industry and the hotel industry's approach to sustainability, and to make sure that we put people and planet first before everything that we do. So within our DNA, we want to be, you know, visionaries. We're establishing a new archetype for development, putting people and planet first. We're innovators, tearing up the rule book, both on how, in terms of how the construction is delivered in Saudi Arabia, some of our forms of contract and ways of doing business with the supply chain, putting people first. So we're, you know, offering people world-class experiences, actively helping the kingdom's people reach their full potential, and then putting the planet first, sustainability being at the core of everything that we do. So we've reached many milestones already, and we've got plenty more to come. So the project was launched back in 2017, the master plan was approved in 2019, and then, you know, our first construction contracts were awarded in 2021. 2023 saw us opening our first resort at Southern Dunes, and in 2024 we opened another two resorts with another two to come later on this year. And then, you know, moving forward into next year, 2025 is a massive year for us. We'll open 11 resorts at the Red Sea and 8 at Amala. And then there's a pipeline of projects at both of those destinations which take us through to 2030, and then further exciting destinations to be announced going forwards. So we are blessed with the support of the government, His Royal Highness Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman bin Abdul Aziz Al Saud is the chairman of the board of directors, and, you know, various ministerial representatives on our board. Our leadership team at Red Sea itself is made up of a mixture of international subject matter sort of experts and prominent Saudis. As I mentioned before, tourism very much at the heart of Saudi Arabia's Vision 2030. The first two destinations that we're working on are the world's most ambitious regenerative tourism destinations. Both of them were born out of Vision 2030 for economic diversification and weaning the kingdom off its dependency on oil revenues. And you know, they'll position the kingdom very firmly on the world tourism map. So we're going beyond sustainability to achieve regeneration in our projects, creating lots of opportunities for talented Saudi men and women, and most importantly, opening up Saudi Arabia to the rest of the world. So moving on into the developments in a little bit more detail. So this map, I'm going to point at this one on this side if that's okay, shows the outline of the Red Sea and the Amala destinations. To give you an idea of the scale, the Red Sea destination from the southernmost point here at Shaybara Island to the north of the lagoon here is about 60 kilometres. This area is called the Al Waj Lagoon. It has about 100 islands in it, of which 22 are designated for developments. We're currently working down in the southern part of, and the western islands of the lagoon. So the resorts that have opened already are Southern Dunes, which is the Six Senses Resort. And then we have the Umahat Islands, which are the St. Regis and the Nzuma, which is a Ritz-Carlton Reserve hotel. Opening shortly will be our own brand hotel, Shebara, owned and operated by Red Sea Global, and also the Desert Rock Hotel is the next in the pipeline for this year. And then next year, all of our focus shifts to this Shura Island here, and Shura has 11 hotels on it and a golf course. Moving on further north, so 150 kilometres north is the Amala destination. Amala Phase 1 is set around an area called Triple Bay. As its name suggests, there are three natural bays in the coastline. The geography at the Amala destination is slightly different from Red Sea. The mountains are much, much closer to the shoreline. So when the hotels are finished, you're going to have this spectacular green, beautiful hotels with the azure blue seas and coral reefs of the Red Sea in front of you, and then a spectacular mountain backdrop behind you. And as I mentioned earlier on, you know, the pipeline going towards 2030 sees us gradually move our way north up through the lagoon and pick up another two or three inland sites at the Red Sea. And then similarly at Amala, we have an area called Triple Bay North. We have a project called the Island. So we'll gradually work our way through some further destinations there as well. I talked a lot already about sustainability, so what does that mean? Both of the projects will set new standards for sustainable development. We're pioneering this partnership between luxury tourism and the environment to achieve a better tomorrow. So all of our resorts are designed to be free of single-use plastics, carbon neutral, not sending any waste to landfill. Both of the destinations are powered 100% off-grid from renewable energy, so we have a series of large photovoltaic solar parks. We've installed over 760,000 PV panels now, and we have one of the world's largest battery storage facilities to store the energy and then transmit it out to the resorts as it's needed. We are targeting a 30% positive conservation benefit by 2040, and all of our buildings are designed and constructed to LEED Platinum standards. So moving on to the socio-economic benefits that I mentioned as well as part of, you know, an important part of delivering on Saudi's Vision 2030, we're creating a lot of jobs, both during the construction phase. You know, the numbers here speak for themselves. 70,000 total jobs during the construction stage at Red Sea, 50,000 at Amala. GDP contribution during construction, 101 billion, 131 billion. When they're finished, they're going to, you know, significantly contribute to GDP. You know, some of the softer areas, we have an elite graduate program where we take the top graduates out of universities across the kingdom and put them through a three-year, you know, very specialized tailored training program to develop and, you know, build the leaders of the future through the vocational training program. And then last but not least, the hospitality scholarships. So tourism, you know, is rapidly developing, so we need a lot of people to work and operate the hotels, so that in itself is presenting great opportunities for the vocational training, people, you know, working in kitchens and you know, guest facing services in the hotels, so all exciting stuff. So the Red Sea. As I mentioned earlier, our first resorts are open to the world. The Six Senses Southern Dunes opened at the end of last year, and the St. Regis and the Ritz-Carlton Reserve both opened at the beginning of this year. They're spectacular, all very different in terms of their offering, their tourist offering. The Six Senses is set about 20 kilometres inland in this amazing location where the mountains meet the sand dunes. And the resort, which was designed by Foster and Partners from London, takes the local architectural styles, and it's very, very thoughtfully laid out. So wherever you are in one of the guest bedrooms in this hotel, you have these spectacular views either out across the mountains or out across the desert. So a very unique hotel prospect. St. Regis was our first island resort to open up. So, you know, a lot of people could be mistaken for thinking this is in the Maldives. This is Saudi Arabia's Red Sea coast. the water is even more spectacular than it is in these photographs when you see it firsthand. And I really encourage everybody to, you know, take the opportunity to come and see just how amazing these resorts are that we're creating. So this is a mixture of beachfront villas and overwater villas. They all have a private pool. Obviously, the beachfront villas have access to the sea, so there's a private beach section in front of it, and then into the water. And the overwater villas have, you know, diving platforms, etc., so you can swim in the sea directly from the door of your villa. So really amazing resort. The Nzuma Ritz-Carlton Reserve opened earlier in the year. I was very privileged to actually take part in some soft opening stuff here. So I tell people it entered the destructive testing phase when my wife and children arrived for the weekend. But we were privileged to spend a weekend in a beachfront villa here, and it was just spectacular. You know, without a doubt, best hotel I've ever stayed in. It really was spectacular. The access to and from the area. So we have an international airport, which is now open. This has been opened in two phases. So we have a main terminal building, which will be completed at the end of this year, operational at the start of next year. And then we have an air taxi terminal. So one of our operational work streams for the hotels is a sea taxi operation, where we guests arriving at the international airport are transferred into seaplanes and then flown out, and the seaplanes land on the sea runways by the islands, and then they're taken from the jetties into the resorts themselves. So we accelerated the construction of the air taxi terminal, and we've been using that in our startup phase as the international arrival departures terminal. So it's a permanent building that we brought forwards and started using earlier. This is the main terminal building. This is like no airport on the planet. When it is completed, the aircraft will actually come and park underneath these petals, and then passengers disembarking the aircraft go downstairs into an arrival garden area, and then carry on through the formalities that you expect with an airport. But it's a really you know, one of a kind airport that we can't wait to welcome our first guests through when it opens next year. I mentioned we've got two more resorts opening this year. I keep telling people I'm not supposed to have a favourite hotel, but this is actually it. This one here, Desert Rock, is what got me back overseas again, having returned to the UK. Desert Rock, it's you know, like nothing I've ever seen before. This is a hotel which is literally built into the side of a mountain. So we drilled and blasted a 180-metre long tunnel through the mountain, and we formed these cave unit guest bedrooms. We also have guest bedrooms in wadis and crevices around the resort as well. It's all very rugged. It's like an almost lunar landscape when you look out across it, but it will give a very, very unique, one-of-a-kind luxury hotel offering. And then the next one is the Shea Bar Island. So anybody who's seen our social media has no doubt seen these stainless steel orbs. They were actually manufactured not very far from here in Sharjah. And then they were put four at a time on a flat-bottomed barge and shipped around around the sea and up into the Red Sea and craned into position. This is a resort that both of these two resorts are ones that we are going to operate ourselves under our own brands. There's a few more images of Shea Bara. So again, you know, the guest bedroom itself has a private swimming pool at the front of it. There's a mixture of beachfront villas and overwater villas, the same as with the other islands, but a very, very unique, one-of-a-kind offering. There's more images of Desert Rock. As I mentioned, you've got some guest bedrooms in crevices, and then you've got the ones built into the side of the mountain itself. So behind the scenes, obviously that many hotels needs a massive infrastructure behind it to support all of the staff and all of the required goods and services to operate the hotels. So this area is called Turtle Bay, which is essentially built for the hotel operator's staff. It's a mixture of villas, townhouses, apartments, studio apartments, and then we have some workers' accommodation buildings in there, which we refer to as the Z types, because they're a Z shape when you look at them on plan. We've constructed this early, and our staff are living in these at the moment, so they're being used during the construction phase, again, with the same as we did with the air taxi terminal. Took some strategic views to bring this one forwards earlier. So the construction staff that are up there have never lived in such a wonderful remote location construction project. In the meantime, we've built these amazing communities that the hotel operator staffs will then take over. So these are actual images of what we've built there, and we've got tennis courts, paddle tennis, baseball, basketball courts. There's a professional beach club there, swimming pools, and then obviously the beach access itself. To the top left-hand corner of the large image at the top is Turtle Bay Hotel, which is a business hotel. So that's where visitors like myself that got there for 2 or 3 days, we stay in the hotel there. That's been open for a couple of years now, and provides a really great accommodation for us when we got there with consultants and interested parties. So I mentioned the big one for next year, Shura Island. So as you can see, Shura Island, it has 11 hotels set around an 18-hole golf course. This is a hive of activity at the moment. The current labour levels on site are about 26,000 people working all of the hours in the day and night to deliver this project. This is joined to the mainland by a causeway bridge. When it's finished, you can see all of the big international hotel brand names there. This is largely a villa product, so individual villas with private pools, some with beach areas in front of them, set around the lush green landscaping that the golf course gives us as well. So this is going to be a really exciting development as it opens next year. Here's some images, not CGIs. So the golf clubhouse, which are the images at the top of the slide here, that's now been completed, and we're actually starting. We've handed it over to the operator, and we'll start to use that for some marketing events and things next year. And then the golf course itself is well under construction. That will be completed towards the end of this year. So we are turning the desert green there. As I mentioned, it's got lots of chalet villa style hotel rooms. And then at the end of the island, we have the main focal point, which is the Grand Hyatt Hotel, which is it's designed to look like a coral bloom. So it has these amazing coloured sunshades all over the top of it. And it's built actually into a mound. So it's quite an elevated property. So it's going to be quite spectacular. And the tail that comes off from it is full of retail dining and entertainment opportunities there as well. So these are just some more images of the construction works. Shura Bridge, as I mentioned, has been completed. We completed it a couple of years ago, and we're using that for road access to and from the island to get the construction workers and the materials and equipment where it needs to be. As we move into our operations phase, we come into all sorts of interesting work streams through our subsidiaries. I pick here mobility. So mobility splits between sea mobility, air mobility, the seaplane fleet, the land mobility, cars and buses. And again, big focus on sustainability here. So an arriving guest gets picked up, taken off to their hotel in an electric vehicle. So all of our passenger vehicles are EVs, the buses are EVs, we've got electric boats that we're using. So all of the greenery that we're planting has to come from somewhere. So we made a strategic decision at the beginning of the project to form our own landscape nursery. This is adjacent to the Turtle Bay area. It's 100 hectares. Or 1 million square meters. I believe it's one of the biggest ones in the region. This is used as somewhere where we grow our own ground cover and shrubs and plants, and we also use it as a a marshalling point for imported materials or products that we're buying in the GCC and bringing to the site, so that they can go through their biosecurity protocols and make sure that we haven't got any infestations of anything that we don't want in the environment. So again, a big focus on controlling that environment as it comes into us, make sure everything's up to the standards that we need, and then it's also ready for just-in-time delivery and planting in the resorts when we need it. This is one of the solar parks. As I mentioned earlier on, there's five of these, I think, five or six, I'll lose count, at the Red Sea destination, and the Amala destination. Similarly, it will have a PPP that delivers the power and the water, again, through sustainable sources. So the PPP infrastructure, it's got its own battery storage areas, district cooling plants serving the Turtle Bay area, and then the various substations and support facilities that are needed around the place for that. We have created 20 acres of new wetlands, which is where the sewage from the resort is treated. So the treated sewage effluent that comes out of the constructed wetlands goes off back into the resorts and irrigates all of the greenery and the landscaping. We're treating about 8,000 cubic meters a day without any chemicals, using these reed bed grasses, and very proud to say that it's actually become a little wildlife haven in its own, and it's attracting new bird species into the area. So that's something that was an added bonus to what we've done there with that as well. So the drinking water comes from reverse osmosis saltwater treatment plants. We have a main plant on the land side, and then the islands have smaller sub-plants producing their drinking water requirements. Moving on to the logistics, these are a couple of our startup phase facilities that we've built. So one, the startup distribution centre is a warehouse. It is split into frozen storage, chilled storage and ambient storage. And we have a logistics and supply chain operation which sees goods consolidated together in a warehouse in Jeddah, long haul transported up to the distribution centre here at the Red Sea, and then the actual delivery to the hotels, the final mile delivery as they refer to it, is by a fleet of electric vans that pick up the food and beverage from the warehouse and then take it out seamlessly out to the hotels, where it then ends up on customers' plates. The transportation centre is primarily for the guest vehicle charging stations. It's where the cars go to get cleaned and make sure that they're all in tip-top order, ready to collect their next passengers. And these are startup facilities, so we have larger facilities for the whole resort, which are both under construction at the moment. So they'll come online in due course. Moving up the coast to Amala, as I mentioned, this is set around three natural bays. The CGI that you see in front of you here actually is the marina. So the marina is man-made, and then the first bay that you see beyond that is natural, and then there are another two beyond that as we head south. So the yacht club itself and the marina has been constructed, it's flooded, it will be underpinned by the yacht club. And the Coralium, which is the working marine life institute at the entrance to the marina itself, and that will be a visitor attraction that people can come and learn about the rich biodiversity of the Red Sea itself. It's got three hotels around it: the Village Boutique, the Equinox Hotel, and Marina Hotel 3, which is one that we haven't announced the brand on yet. So hence, it's got a secret code. Moving, these are photographs, not CGIs. So this is the Coralium at the front, and then the hotels under construction around the marina itself. This is the next bay down, which is the Triple Bay Four Seasons Resort. This is a mixture of individual bedrooms, individual villa-type guest bedrooms, and then there's some stacked product in here as well. With all of the pools and landscaped areas around it. This is the Six Senses Resort. And then we have further down in the next bay, the Rosewood Resort, which has 110 hotel keys, 26 units. This is a very luxurious brand. The theme at the Amala destination is all about wellness. So this is a wellness and spa type resort for the guests. Triple Bay Central has the Four Seasons Resort, the Rosewood Resort, Six Senses. These are just some more images of the construction. And as I mentioned earlier on, you can start to see between the shoreline and this spectacular mountain backdrop, the geography, the physical geography of the area is quite different at the Amala destination from the Red Sea destination. The Triple Bay Wellness Core, so this is where the Clinique La Prairie Health Resort is located, and the JSM Wellness Resort. These are some construction images of those two resorts as they're progressing. We also, at Amala, have a private aviation runway. And the same as at Red Sea, we have a big staff village which provides will provide all of the permanent accommodation for the hotel operator staff. We've started the first phases of this. I'll come on to it in a moment, but the area to the right-hand side of the CGI that you see on the screen here, the green dots in there are cricket pitches. We have food and beverage, retail, Shell and Core retail units in there. There's a cinema, and we have some villas for the hotel managers. We have a school and a nursery, and a hospital, fire station, security headquarters. So, mirroring all of those back of house facilities that we also have at the Red Sea destination. These are fairly up-to-date images. We've finished the first few buildings in here. We've actually got people living in them now. So again, brought that construction forwards. We're using it for our construction staff so that they're not living in porta cabin tin sheds. They're living in permanent buildings, and they've got great facilities down there, giving them a really nice place to live and nice lifestyle. This is the porta cabin village. Which I always say when I go up there that I'm going to the resort. It's the best construction, labour camp, staff village that I've ever stayed in. Many years of doing this in all sorts of places around the world. The facilities here are great. Good food, good out of work activities, sports activities there for all of the staff who are based in the construction village. Same as at the Red Sea, we have the shared facilities behind the scenes here. So again, sewage treatment, we've got reverse osmosis saltwater treatment plants, we've got warehousing, we've got the transport hubs, and then all of the admin facility operations requirements behind the scenes. So on to procurement. Our procurement team is headed by Mohammed Al-Fadan, who's sat here in the front row. So if any of you need to see him afterwards, then he is here. Don't let him run away. Mohammed's team is split primarily into projects. So we have projects procurement for the Red Sea, projects procurement for Amala. We then have a team that look after the FF&E and OS&E requirements for the hotel, which with this number of hotels opening, at the same time, you can imagine is no small order to get all of that coordinated from around the world. We then have a team that look after all of the procurement requirements for the operations and the facilities management work streams. And then we have corporate and CCC is a little in-house construction entity that we have doing some specific elements of the works. And then our vendor management team. So our approach in terms of the development of the projects is different from Saudi Arabia's traditional method of delivering construction projects. In the past, the focus would have been on the employer hiring a project management consultant and architects and engineers, and then hiring a main contractor, and the main contractor delivering the project, and then the disputes being dealt with at the end of the project, and everybody probably having a big fight along the way. I used to be a contractor, so I'm a bit sort of jaded on this approach. We've taken a completely different approach for Saudi, which is to use this construction management approach. So we don't generally employ big main contractors. We go directly into contract with the specialist suppliers and manufacturers and contractors. We divide the projects up into the sort of key areas of marine, infrastructure, civil, facades and envelopes, the MEP systems, the FF&E, the finishes, and the enabling works. So typically, a hotel for us, or a warehouse for us, or a school, or a hospital, or whatever it is that we're building, will be divided up into those 30 works packages. And you know, we will then enter into competitive tenders to obtain prices, select the contractor that we want to appoint, and then that contractor is appointed directly to Red Sea Global as the employer. And you know, the payments flow from Red Sea to the contractor. There's no middleman. You know, we're very proud that we don't have lots of festering problems with people where we have, you know, construction's not straightforward. It's not straightforward anywhere in the world. Otherwise, everybody would be doing it. But you know, we have challenges and we deal with them as we go through. So we have a good track record of proactively dealing with anything as and when it arises. And you know, that is really, to me, it's now demonstrated by the number of companies that come and see Mohammed and I. They want more work. They want to work with us. They want to move their businesses from Qatar or from, you know, Egypt or wherever it might be, and you know, and do work in Saudi Arabia with us, because we are seen as a good customer to work for, that treats people fairly. You know, we expect people to work hard, but you know, you'll get treated fairly for working hard for us. So that's underpinned also by our contracting approach. So bane of my life when I was a contractor was scratching around at the last minute of a competitive tender to obtain a tender bond, phoning around the world and trying to get approvals from board directors, etc., and then trying to get the paperwork out of the bank before a deadline was looming, etc. So we as an organisation, we don't ask for tender bonds from our bidders. We have various forms of contract, from short forms for minor works to long forms based on the FIDIC terms. And it's not a one-size-fits-all approach. So, you know, Greg, who's speaking tomorrow, is the head of legal. Him and his team have got a very flexible approach to this, making sure that we tailor the contract agreement to the task at hand. So it's not just a, you know, here's your FIDIC contract, and yeah, you might only be coming in to put the curtains up, but here's a 100-page contract. That doesn't work. So we, you know, we tailor the contracts to the requirements of them. Favorable payment terms. So Saudi Arabia is on a journey at the moment with this. We have 56-day payment terms generally in our contracts, very, very much encouraged by the chief executive across the whole of the organisation to beat that, and we strive to pay people within 30 days. That's actually been picked up on by our colleagues at the PIF, and they're running a pilot now, of which we're participating in, to see about rolling that out, you know, further afield. So watch this space, but it's certainly a lot better than it used to be. Again, we don't have a one-size-fits-all approach to advanced payments. It's not, you've got 10% and that's it. You know, we appreciate that some off-site manufactured packages require more cash up front because they don't get any money until the stuff's been delivered otherwise. So we have, you know, a variable, flexible approach to the advance payments depending on the nature of the package. And we work very much with the supply chain to make sure that it works, works for both parties. As I mentioned before, timely payments direct from the employer. That'll be music to a lot of people's ears, I'm sure. Performance bonds are released at the taking over certificate. We have cash retention, or we have the option to provide a retention bond to cover anything during the defects liability period, so we can release the performance bonds when the projects are taking over, and a flexible approach to the retention as well. In numbers, we've awarded 73.3 billion Saudi riyals across both destinations to date. Last year was a big year for us. Mohammed told me he couldn't possibly do more than 25 because I told him he needed to do 30. He did it over 25. He kind of met me in the middle at 27.3 billion. So it was a big year last year. This year is shaping up to be very much the same in terms of values. So significant values, big pipeline going forward, still lots of opportunities, and not just focused on those construction work streams. We're now into the operations work streams. So there's lots of opportunities for diverse spectrum of suppliers, we have further developments at various stages of the master planning. So it doesn't stop just at Red Sea and Amala. There will be future developments that that come out to the market. So in terms of the supply chain opportunities for construction packages, I'll leave this on the screen. If anybody wants to take a photo, you can do, or the slides will no doubt be shared afterwards. This is split up into those 30 or so packages that we have for the typical construction projects. Our registration process is all run through SAP Ariba. So if you visit our website, I have a QR code in a moment that you can also scan. But if you visit our website, it will lead. There's an option there to register as a supplier, and you follow all of the steps through there. I would caution everybody that it's a two-stage process. So the first stage, you have to complete a global code of conduct and a confidentiality undertaking agreement, and then you have to sign them and upload them. The system will then automatically email you back and say, yes, we've received those, thank you very much, here's your vendor manager, here's your vendor number, and that's the trap. People get that email and think, finished now, I'm all done. The second stage of it actually is you should then be contacted by Mohammed's vendor management team to arrange to provide some further documents to complete your registration process. And that's typically about your corporate profile, your size, your financial statements, etc. What types of projects and goods and services are you interested in supplying? And then a crucial part of that is that we arrange capability meetings, so you're given the opportunity to, usually they're done on Teams virtual meetings, to present your service offering to the right people in the organization. So if you're a piling contractor, you'll meet people from Red Sea that know about piling, so that we get the right people in the right room so that you speak in the same language in whatever the goods and services are. So this is the QR code, if anybody wants to scan that, I'll leave it up there for a moment. It's a straightforward process. Mohammed has a strong team in vendor management who are able to assist with any issues or any problems that you might have. So please, it's the entry point to any relationship with Red Sea Global. The first point is to do the registration. And then we'll take it from there. You'll then, once your registration's complete, you'll be invited to participate in tenders, and hopefully we'll see you very soon on our projects. So that concludes my presentation, if anybody has any questions.
Thank you very much, Ben. We are taking questions, so if anyone has questions, please raise your hand. There we go.
Except if it's difficult, I'll get Mohammed to answer it. So,
very simple question. Where does IT fit into your 30-plus process? Technology, IT, yeah?
ICT and ELV is the package, isn't it? ELV systems.
So this be under MEP or?
No, it's usually separate from the MEP.
Oh, separate?
Yeah, it's a separate package.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay, you're welcome.
Any other questions?
Thank you very much. I see all your projects, you are inviting contractors, but we are also investors here. Is there any plans to invite investors to come and participate in your projects, like the logistics, projects like the residential projects, we can come and invest in these projects?
Okay. There we go. So Yeah, the simple answer is yes, there are opportunities, and Greg's the person that actually you need to speak to on that, so it's good that he's here in the room.
There's a question.
Okay, thank you.
So when do you guys decide to work with external procurement companies versus doing procurement yourselves?
So we use external procurement companies sometimes on the FF&E and the OS&E, purely because of the volume of purchase orders that gets generated when you're fitting out a hotel. So we do some ourselves. It's a balance. We do some in-house, but we use procurement agents as well for the FF&E. That is the only area where we use external procurement resource. The everything else is handled in-house by Mohammed and his army of buyers.
Thank you very much. Wonderful show. Do you have any plans for inbound tourism to Red Sea?
For what, sorry?
Inbound tourism to Red Sea.
For inbound tourism? I'm not sure I understand in the terminology.
To bring in tourists for the leisure purpose to Red Sea.
To bring in tourists?
Tourists, yeah. Which is the nearest airport?
I'm not entirely sure of the subject, so perhaps we could talk afterwards.
Sure.
Yeah.
There's another question.
So within our operational work streams, we have a whole variety of offerings to the tourists. So we have subsidiaries that deal with water sports. So we have a diving subsidiary. We have water sports. So we have below the water, above the water. We have land-based adventure sports subsidiary. We have things, doing stargazing trips out to the desert at night, etc. So there's a whole variety of entertainment offerings at the resorts.
Thank you very much. A quick question. A lot was mentioned about contractors again. Back to the contractor point.
Yeah.
Is there any opportunity for vendors to directly work with Red Sea and not just go through contractors?
So there are. It depends on the nature of the vendor. What we've done over the last year is we've developed quite a lot of supply chain agreements with specific vendors. So where it's a product or a goods or a service that we continuously require across lots of projects, we're trying to sort of hone in on suppliers that we like the product it suits within our offering, the supplier likes working with us, and we have preferred supplier agreements with them, and then they are, they're engaged by the contractors, but they have a relationship with Red Sea Global, so they get treated, well.
We are leading a vendor master list, which is led by a procurement team. You can approach us directly, then we will do all needful and the arrangements. Once you get approved, we will add you into that list, then we will share it with our contractors. But you don't have to approach them directly. We will facilitate and ease this.
Okay, thank you.
We still have a few minutes.
Oh, there's a lady at the back there who's got her hand up.
Happy to continue.
Yeah, that's fine, yeah.
Hello, my name is Natasha, and I would like to actually appreciate Red Sea Global. I've done 3 projects with them. It is one of the most easiest vendor registration with them, and they are so good with payments, and that's it. They're just one of the most amazing people I've ever worked with in my 15 years of my career.
Thank you very much. That makes me very proud. That means they're doing what they should be doing. So.
That's a beautiful testimonial. So my name is Petra, Catch International, and my question is how the residential elements are standing in the whole somehow setup and the puzzle, hearing about the hotels and obviously the accommodation for the staff, but then the residential parts, which you are developing, could you tell us a little bit more about that, please?
I can. Yeah, they fall into 2 categories. So we have some branded residences in conjunction with the hotels, which are, investors invest in them, and then they're operated by the hotels on a a rental return basis, and then we have private residential offerings as well. So the next island that we have at the Red Sea is called Lahek Island, and that one has 570 villas on it, something like that. And again, they're set around the golf course, so that they will be sold to private purchasers. We have a residential sales and marketing team within RSG who are responsible for, you know, for doing those residential sales and taking those, you know, those customers right the way through the guest journey, from looking at something, coming and visiting our show homes on the site and the sales centre, and buying something off plan, and then, you know, being handed the keys to a finished property at the end. So, and there will be residential. There's some residential in Triple Bay area at Amala. Not very much. Some of the future projects there introduce some more, and there's one development there, which follow it. It will go along one of the ridge lines of the mountains. It's going to be amazing real estate property when that one's been built up there. So, thank you.
Thank you very much for the presentation. You briefly spoke about vocational training and the graduate program. So is that done internally, or is it in collaboration with someone?
Yeah, it's run internally. So we've been running the hotel hospitality vocational training. We've been running in Jeddah, and we're actually looking at setting up our own academy in the local area here. And the landscape nursery particularly, we've focused on the local area, so we've got lots of people who live in the surrounding villages and towns who travel up there. They've been trained on the job at the landscape nursery, but they're run in-house. Yeah.
Thank you very much for the for the presentation, very insightful. I was particularly impressed by the developments around the airport. Incredible. Are you envisioning any strategic partnerships with private aviation companies in order to support the development of the luxury offering within the region?
Greg? There we go. I'm glad Greg came today.
Thank you. Very impressive. So obviously, a lot of great hotels coming, impressive, building a world, but how are you going to make this sustainable? Through airlift? What are the plans on airlift? We all know airlift can be, it's the only trigger to bring people in. And then other attractions, obviously, around entertainment, food and beverage, to have the residents ultimately stay there and live there to make it a home, not just as a one-off great hotel experience. What are the airlift plans ultimately?
So in terms of the Turtle Bay village that I described to you earlier on, we have all of those facilities there. There are, you know, shops and restaurants in there. There is the school, there's a hospital. So it will be gradually developed as that that residential population grows up there. But it's designed around second homes rather than people, you know, being there full time all of the time. But the core facilities are part of the development.
Once the Shura asset comes online, the hope is you're going to start building more curiosity out of markets, feeder markets like Western Europe and elsewhere. The airport can take A380s. I mean, the plan is obviously to build up lift commensurate with the demand segments coming out of the hotels. And then, as Ben indicated also, we have significant resi product. So people that are living there more seasonally or for longer than just a 4, 5, 6 night stay will be part of the lift equation as well. So it's a little bit of a chicken egg dynamic. But obviously, that's a significant thing we're monitoring, including also potential private, you know, collaborations. So.
Sorry, thank you.
What is the
climate?
Do you mean the weather? The weather is it's amazing. It's 330 days-ish of sunshine and more kind of in the 32 to 34 Celsius zip code. So it's not as hot as Riyadh. It's a little more humid, but it's not as humid as Jeddah. So we like to think we're in a little bit of a sweet spot where you don't get the 42, 43, 44 that you might get at the height of the summer in Riyadh, but you don't have the humidity you'd have in Dubai or Jeddah. So we like to think of it as a year-round destination. Obviously, there'll be some seasonality, probably, but we're trying to build it as a year-round destination.
Any other questions from the audience? I think we still have 5 minutes.
That's good.
Thank you for that. That was really impressive. Quick one on the branded residences.
Yep.
Are you seeing any particular nationality coming to invest more, or has this been overall kind of a general kind of consensus?
I'm not close to that, I'm afraid.
Respect to airlift. So currently the vast majority of interest in the Resi product is KSA Nationals, though there's some initial indications of more GCC curiosity from kind of the immediate region. But again, in the fullness of time, our plan and our sales plan already contemplates selling internationally, selling to international customers, the Resi. I think we just need to have a little bit more of a critical mass on the first round of residential that we're focused more on the KSA market.
Else? Last chance to ask Ben any of your questions. Thank you so much, Ben,
Thank
for
you.
Your time and for the Red Sea team.